medical care gaps? What are they and why are they important for your health, happiness and survival? To understand medical care gaps, you need to first understand what are national standards. For any chronic medical problem that you may have, be it diabetes, be it high blood pressure, asthma, high cholesterol, heart failure, and so many more, for all of them, there are certain standards which are called national standards. These standards are written by experts and doctors in the field, and nobody really benefits from writing these standards, not the pharmaceutical company, not the HMO, but these standards are purely based on the past experience or evidence in medicine that has been published. To give you a similarity to how standards work, when you drive a car, there is a standard that your wheel should have so much pressure of air so that your car can run smoothly. If the pressure is less, there will be traction, drag on the car, and it will not work well. Similarly, there are standards in medicine for various chronic medical illnesses, and if they are not followed, your body will suffer. And this suffering manifests itself as more emergency room visits, more hospitalizations, more disability, and even early death. Let me give you some examples. Many years ago, they saw that diabetes causes blindness. So diabetics, if they have diabetes for some time, they become blind. So they recommended a national standard that every diabetic should have an eye exam. When lasers came, they could now stop the bad effect of diabetes in the eyes and could prevent blindness. So the standard was changed to that every diabetic should have an eye exam every 2 years. Later on, they saw that if you wait for 2 years after the first exam, some people still develop changes by 2 years which are difficult to treat. So the standard was changed to that every diabetic should have a yearly eye exam. And so now the national standard is that every diabetic should have a yearly eye exam. There are similarly hundreds and hundreds of standards for various diseases and also for wellness and prevention. There is a standard that breast cancer screening mammography in females should start at 40 years of age because the evidence showed that if it starts at 30, then there is more damage to the body through radiation from the X-rays that are needed to do the mammography. And if it is started late, say at 50, then we miss more breast cancers. So after a lot of evidence, they came to the conclusion that it should start at 40 years of age, and that is a national standard. Now, nobody can challenge these standards unless there is a reason in your particular case, like you have a family history of breast cancer, then your mammography can be started earlier, or if you are pregnant at the age of 40 years, then it could be slightly delayed. But barring those conditions, the national standard is that the mammography to screen for breast cancer should start at 40 years of age, and nobody can challenge it. Similarly, there are standards for cholesterol control levels. In the past, the levels were considered normal when the bad cholesterol was 130. Experience showed that if the cholesterol is that high, people suffer more heart attack and strokes. So for special circumstances, this level was decreased to 100 as normal. Even at 100, they saw that some patients who have other risk factors for heart attack suffered more heart attacks, so the level in those patients is now recommended to be around 70. So this is a national standard. Nobody can challenge this standard, because in most cases these standards are based on hundreds of thousands of patients' data, and they are not guided by any pharmaceutical company, any HMO, not even the government. Nobody can interfere and come and dictate standards. The implementation of the standards can be dictated. So the government can say, okay, everybody should have mammography and we will make it free. But they cannot say that the mammography should start at 30 or 50 years of age when the standard is at 40 years of age. So I'm trying to explain to you the power that is behind these standards. And if these standards or national standards or national guidelines are not followed, there are more chances of emergency room visits or hospitalizations to the hospital or disability or even early death. And we will see many examples of these national standards and where and how they are not being met currently. So what is an MCG or medical care gap? What you should have received as part of your medical care as defined by national standards to prevent short and long-term complications from your medical condition, but you did not receive, is a medical care gap for you. You would like to ask yourself a question as to whose fault is it that you have medical care gaps? Is it your HMO's fault, your doctor's fault, or is it anybody else's fault, or is it your fault? It will not help at this stage to try to find out whose fault it is, because all the parties listed here can share some blame for some medical care gaps somewhere in patient's care. But that will not help, because the only person who will suffer because of these medical care gaps or MCGs will be you. You will suffer financially, physically, socially, and you may even end up dying earlier because of these medical care gaps. So the priority now is to find out how to identify and fix these MCGs before it is too late. Once you have fixed the MCGs, you can do whatever you want to do, but let's first find out and remove the gaps in medical care that you have. The question arises as to how many MCGs can be there and in an individual's care. And the answer is that it could be hundreds to thousands, depending on how many medical condition does the patient have and how well they are managed. It also depends on the patient's age, sex, ethnic origin, lifestyle, family history, past history, and so many other factors. So you can imagine that medical care gaps could be a few or could be many more, depending on so many factors. So how do you find out how many medical care gaps that you have? To do that, you will need to get a report card on your health, which will give you a list of gaps in your care based on the national standards that are out there. Now, when I go to educate people about health related conditions, I ask them two questions. First, I ask them, do you think we have a very bad healthcare system? The quality of care that is provided in our system is very bad, and I see everybody raising his or her hand. Then I ask, how many of you believe that you are getting bad care? You are not getting a good quality care. And I don't see a single hand going up. Now, that means there is some disconnect, that when we believe that the system is providing very poor quality care and we are getting care from that system and our care is perfect. And there can be many reasons for one's believing so. One may think that they have a health insurance, so they won't have MCGs or medical care gaps. All the data we will share with you in part 2 of this presentation is from patients who had health insurance. You may be thinking you live in a nice neighborhood in a nice zip code, but the data we will show you will clearly show whatever county or state you live in, your care is likely to be equally bad. You may think you are educated, so you will not have medical care gaps, and again, the data will refute this fact. You may think that you are going to your doctor's office and you are taking all the medication prescribed to you, and again, the data in part 2 is from all the patients that were going to doctor's offices and were on medication. You may be thinking that you go for yoga, meditation, you have joined a health club, you go for regular exercise, but none of those is going to fix the medical care gap in your health care or in your medical care. In a very few cases, it may improve your care, but in most cases, all these and many more other things will not fix medical care gaps. If we go back to our example of patient with diabetes who did not have an eye exam, or if a patient who should have had a mammogram but did not have a mammogram, you can imagine none of these things will help. You may be thinking you attend sincerely all company-sponsored programs, including on weight loss, smoking cessation, wellness management and prevention, and those are all good programs, but they are not going to fix the MCGs or medical care gaps which you have in your care as of today. The effect, the benefits of all these programs that you see listed here, financially and medically, will come 5 or 10 years down the road. But the medical care gaps that you have will cost you today, tomorrow, and every other day after that, unless they are fixed. You may be thinking that you read everything available on your health condition from magazines, you watch TV shows, you read on internet, but again, just reading will not fix your medical care gaps. And to fix the medical care gaps, you need to have a report card on your health. Being in denial because of all the other reasons and the reasons that we discussed just now will not help you, and what you don't know and what you don't fix today will cost you tomorrow and every other day after tomorrow till it is fixed. Now, this is a slide which is very interesting, because the question is, who wants to fix your medical care gaps? And the answer is, the answer will surprise you. It is your HMO who wants to fix your medical care gaps, because they save money when your gap is removed. So a lady who did not have a mammogram, if she goes for a mammogram, gets diagnosed with breast cancer at an earlier stage, it's a $5,000 expense for the HMO. But if the lady misses on mammogram and gets late stage breast cancer, the expenses could run in hundreds of thousands of dollars. So your HMO wants to fix your health care gaps and your doctor, because in many places they are now even paid based on how many medical care gaps the patients have. They even have a special interest now in removing the medical care gaps from your care. Your family, friends, of course, they want to see you healthy. They don't want to see you disabled. Government at federal and state level, your employer, your boss, everybody, they pay for your health care directly or indirectly. And if nothing else is the reason, that is one reason that they want the medical care gaps removed from your medical care. That they want that there should be no gap, which will cost a much more money in the future. And above all, me and my partners, we want to fix your medical care gaps. We started fixing medical care gaps for patients in 2002, and we were doing it telephonically, and from 2006 onwards we have put it on website that you can go in your own time and remove the gaps from your medical care. So everybody is trying to help you fix the medical care gaps that you have. Now it is up to you to take the initiative and remove them. One question that sometimes people are afraid of, that it is something being recommended, so it will cost money. And the answer is no, it will not cost you money. You have already paid for it when you bought your health insurance. And the same is true for Medicaid and Medicare. Everybody will pay for all the medical care gap removal that we recommend, because it is based on national guideline. The only expense you may have may be your coinsurance, and that is all. So it is something for which you have paid thousands of dollars in your health insurance, but you are not using it. So it is time that you identify, you come to know what are the gaps in your medical care, and fix them before it's too late. So what will fix the MCGs? It is knowing them, understanding them, and correcting them one by one. It's a systematic, methodical process, and it succeeds. This is the only way to fix your medical care gaps. We strongly recommend that you go to meandmyhealth.com, log in, and find out about what are the gaps as of today. What are the medical care gaps in your medical care as of today? Print the report card, print the to-do list action card, and start working on them, that in 3 to 6 months time you are free of all MCGs or medical care gaps, and your medical care is optimized based on the national standards. Let's see what is the data available to support the presence of medical care gaps. Time magazine in December of 2008 came out with the story of state of American health, and they said that we spend the highest amount of money per person per year, which is about $7,000, and it's rapidly increasing. And we will end up spending 20% of our GDP soon on our healthcare. When they looked at where this money is being spent, about 20 cents out of a dollar are spent on administrative and other costs. Out of the 80 cents that is spent on direct patient care, 31 cents, so it goes to almost about 40% of our expenses, are hospital care, which is much higher than anywhere else. Texas Department of Health showed that out of 14 causes of admission to the hospital, 12 are preventable, and these include bacterial pneumonia, they include chronic medical conditions like angina, heart failure, high blood pressure, asthma, COPD due to smoking, short-term complications of diabetes like a high sugar or a low sugar, long-term complications of diabetes like kidney failure, heart attack, stroke, leg amputation, etc., uncontrolled diabetes, and lower extremity, that is leg amputation in patients with diabetes. So to recapitulate, common causes of admission to the hospital are angina, heart failure, high blood pressure, asthma, COPD, diabetes. This is what leads to hospital admissions, and excessive hospital admissions in turn lead to excessive spending on healthcare. So if we can fix this, we can decrease the number of admissions to the hospital, which in turn will decrease the healthcare costs. Department of Health has an agency called Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality, and this is the data from that agency, which showed that even if we follow one parameter for a disease, like this green parameter is for diabetes, blue is for cholesterol, and black is for high blood pressure. Usually you have to follow 15 to 20 parameters for various conditions, but if even if we look at one parameter, they found out that in almost 45% of patients, even today, the care has severe gaps. Only 55% patients, or in 55% incidences, the care is complete for one parameter. So if they would have looked for all the three parameters in each patient, this number would have been much lower. However, the meaning of this is that from here to here, there are about 12 million diabetics whose care is poor, and this is what we saw caused hospital admissions. If we look at hypertensives, millions of high blood pressure patients have poor control of blood pressure, and we saw this is a common cause of admissions. Millions and millions of patients with cholesterol have their cholesterol under poor control, and we saw that heart attack, heart failure, angina were common causes of admission to the hospital. So this is what we call as medical care gap, and if we can eliminate this, if all these numbers go up here to about 100%, then the number of admissions to the hospital will decrease and the healthcare expenses will decrease. Those who believe that the things are getting better because there is so much focus on healthcare and wellness and on-site clinics and so many other things that you are hearing about, there is no change, in my opinion, no significant change. We have hardly moved from say 40% to 50% in 12 years or more. Actually, it is more like 18 years. So each year there is only 1% change on an average, and things have remained extremely poorly controlled. The government's own website says that this poor control leads to heart attacks, kidney failure, needing dialysis and kidney transplant, blindness and stroke, etc. When they looked at if a diabetic is getting care for three parameters out of 15 or 20 they should follow, they saw that less than 45% patients, actually 40% patients only, are getting the right care. So if you look at statistically, then 6 out of 10 patients are not getting care for even 3 parameters. When we look at 15 parameters, this number will be much lower. Just as you may believe that you are amongst these 40% patients, everybody else also believes the same thing. So there has to be somebody who is not getting care for these parameters. So this gap in medical care leads to, again, hospital admissions and excessive expenditure. This data here shows that even when you are admitted with heart failure, 25% chances are you will not get the care you should be getting. So the best strategy is remove all medical care gaps from your care, so that you don't have to go to emergency room, so that you don't have to be admitted to the hospital, and medical care gaps can be removed very easily. Another data shows that pneumonia can be prevented by one injection in a lifetime in most cases, and here we decided that by 2010 we will achieve a target of 90%, but we have hardly improved the quality of care. So for all those who say things are getting better because we are spending more and more money, or because government is focusing on that, or because the health plans are focusing on that, or because my doctor is focusing on that, the data does not support that view. The data also shows that we live shorter lives despite spending the highest money on healthcare, and I hope that by now you understand why we live shorter lives. The kidney failures, the strokes, the heart failures, they kill at a younger age. A person who should have lived to be 65 or 70 or 75 or 80 now dies at 50 or 55 or at much younger age because of these complications. This is the data from New Jersey, which shows that even after a heart attack, 40% patients do not have their cholesterol well managed, and these patients therefore are prone to second heart attack, which has a much higher death rate, which has much higher expenses, which has much higher rate for disability for patients. And this is true for all the health plans. Each bar here is one health plan in New Jersey, so all the health plans are in similar range. Same is the data for beta blocker tablet to prevent a heart attack after the first heart attack, that 20% patients are not getting it. Whatever the health plan, it doesn't make much difference. Control of blood pressure. More than 1 in 3 patients do not have their pressure under control, and these patients will suffer from kidney failure, stroke, and heart failure. And all those we saw are common causes of admissions to the hospital, and all these are very expensive items. Eye exam in diabetics. Almost 50% patients do not have eye exam with diabetes as recommended. So we can imagine that every other patient suffering from diabetes is just waiting to go blind in a few years time, 5 years, 10 years. And along with eye damage comes other damages to the body, including to the kidney, including heart attack and stroke, and that is why the expenses are high and life expectancy is low. Data for breast cancer screening. Despite spending billions of dollars on breast cancer research and treatment, even if you look at 2-year data, actually in most cases the screening should be done every year, but even if you look at 2-year data, then 1 in 3 of female patients who should have mammography did not have it, and the outcome is that a procedure which would have cost $100 may end up costing $100,000 when the cancer is diagnosed, because the patient will need surgery, breast reconstruction, chemotherapy, radiotherapy, and many more types of therapies. And something which could be saved, which could be diagnosed at a stage where a few thousands dollars worth of surgery would have sufficed, will not only put the patient's life at risk, but will also cost a lot of money. Data for treatment for depression in New Jersey. And New Jersey is not the only state. This report from New York State HMO IPRO shows that at a national level we have less than 50% patients with heart attack or heart surgery. Remember, heart attack costs almost $30,000 to $50,000, heart surgery costs $100,000. Even after that, only less than 50% of patients have their cholesterol under control. These patients are waiting to have another heart attack. And we told that another heart attack is much more expensive and much more dangerous. In some parts of the country, this rate of control of cholesterol is as low as 8%. And these are all the health plans in New York. As you can see, none is having a 90% or 100% rate of control. So if you think that because you have a health insurance or because your health plan is good, it doesn't matter. Similar data for other parameters, blood sugar control in diabetes, data for eye exam. As a nation, less than 50% patients had eye exam as recommended when they had diabetes, meaning thereby that almost 12 million patients in the US are waiting to go blind because they did not have a very simple eye exam that would have taken 15 minutes and that would have cost less than $100. This data has been consistent year over year. New England Journal of Medicine, which is one of the most prestigious journal, came to the same conclusion that wherever you live, you will be receiving very poor quality of health care, whether you are rich, whether you are poor, whether you live in nice neighborhoods, whether you live in not so nice neighborhoods, whether you are educated, whether you are not educated, everybody will get poor health care. This data is further supported by the fact that if you look at all counties getting health care in California and compare this data, focus on this line, these two lines, with other years, it is with, and you compare it with other counties, it is exactly the same, very similar data for different counties. So wherever you live, even if you live in Los Angeles, even if you live in San Diego, you will get the same level of care. And I mentioned those two cities because one place is considered to have the richest people in the country living in Hollywood, and the second place is supposed to have the most educated people living in the area, and all of them are getting an extremely poor quality of care. Whatever they may believe, that is not true. Even for the most serious of conditions to prevent second heart attack, they are getting similar care. As you will see, these are different counties and this is data from different counties. All of them have a third care missing. These horizontal lines are, dark lines are where people got care, and here they didn't get care, and these are various health plans. County after county, similar results. If you look at data year after year, it's the same poor result. It should be 4 plus for the right care. In 2007, the data is like this. If you just memorize the picture, 2006, it looks the same. 2005, it looks the same. Here, 1 star is equivalent to 2 stars in the previous two diagrams. 2004 looks the same. 2003 looks the same. So nothing has changed in 5 years except that the patients who have those conditions are gradually walking towards disability and even death. With time, things have gotten worse. This is data from 2003. For medication to prevent heart attack, 93% patients got the medication then. In 2008, only 74% patients got it. Breast cancer screening rates from 73% in 2003 have fallen to 69% in 2008. So despite spending all this money, things are not getting better. And there is a lot of data supporting the same view. California Healthcare Performance for Quality reviewed data that this time they looked at not that how much care the patient is getting, but how much care the doctor is providing. And they looked at 14 parameters, important common parameters, and they came to the conclusion that on an average, a patient is getting 58% care than he or she should be receiving from the doctor in California. And California data is at least 10% better than the data from rest of the nation. Now these are the means. So when it says 58% mean care, some doctors may be providing 95% care, but with the same token, some doctors will be providing 30% of the care. And just thinking that I have the best doctor, I am getting the best care will not help, because everybody else is also thinking the same thing. So the only way to find out if you are getting the right care or not is to plug your data in a program which can tell you whether your care is optimal or not, and we will show that to you in the next step. We saw what are medical care gaps, and we saw that they are present in almost everybody's care. And we also saw how dangerous they can be in causing short and long-term complications. During that part of the presentation, I told you that I will show you a very easy way to correct your medical care gaps in 3 to 6 months. To do that, you go to meandmyhealth.com and you log in using your private user ID and password. You will be taken to a screen where you choose what medical conditions you have. Here we have chosen diabetes and asthma, and I will show you example of diabetes. Even if you are totally healthy, you need to answer questions about wellness assessment, which is here. Once you click on the condition you have chosen, you will be given a list of questions written in very simple language that anybody can easily understand and answer. And these questions evaluate your health condition as per national guidelines as to what you are doing right, what else you need to do to avoid complications. There is also instant learning available attached to the question. These questions are all the questions your doctor should be asking you when you go to him or her. And as you can see, even answering these questions will take you anything from 30 to 120 minutes. So it's practically impossible for a doctor to ask you all these questions and educate you on all these things that are here. Once you have answered all the questions relating to your condition, you will request to get a report by clicking at submit. And this is the type of report you will get. You can email this report to yourself, or you can print report card and action card individually. The report card tells you that based on the national standards, what is missing from your care that will cause short or long term complications that will make you go to the emergency room or hospital, and how you can eliminate that medical care gap that is there in your medical care. Now again, whatever is written in report card is written at a very simple level of understanding that everybody can understand it, and there is no advertisement anywhere on our website of anything. This is like a book written for your health. You don't have to buy 10 books, read 10 books or do anything. This single book is specifically written for you as to what you are doing right, what you need to do, and how to do it, what will happen if you don't do it. So it's in nutshell everything you need to know about your condition and optimizing it based on the national guidelines. And this is the example for diabetic patient. If the report card is long, don't worry, it is a good news that so many of the deficiencies in your care were caught, and then they can be fixed in next 3 to 6 months. The second part of the report is called action card, and this is a list of actions. Some of them need to be taken by you, some of them by your doctor, and some of them by other members of the team taking care of you. You can take this action card, attach it to your file, and then everybody will need to focus on these medical care gaps with the hope that in 3 months' time, your medical care will be optimal, free of medical care gaps. So it was so simple to identify and correct the medical care gaps. You can also learn about other medical conditions in the library portion of the ARAM site, and we have over 400 audio, video and read formats for various medical conditions. You can also update your daily data and keep a record of it for a long time, 2-3 years, to see what is the trend and can share it with your care provider. So we believe that there is no reason for you now not to fix the medical care gaps that are there in your care and optimize your care as soon as possible. So we showed you what are medical care gaps, why they are important for your health, happiness and very survival. Now let the light of knowledge remove the darkness of ignorance and let you have the wisdom to make the right decision at the right time through the great light of knowledge that you will achieve through knowing and understanding your medical care gaps.